Well, good day, ladies and gentlemen from Washington. I'm Robert Christian, and this is the Robert Christian Show. Some of the news headlines that we have been following do include the passing of John Glenn, the iconic astronaut and politician who died at the age of 95. We are going to be talking a little bit about John Glenn and about some of the things that he actually did, perhaps that you will remember, and in hopes that maybe that it will help to enlighten your path a little bit as we remember John Glenn, and Godspeed to him. Also making the news stack today, Mitch McConnell said today, actually, that Democrats need to take a yes for an answer versus taking a no for an answer. He said that he will keep working next year to resolve the fight over health care benefits for coal miners. Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell is urging the coal state Senate Democrats to take the yes for an answer, as a block of Democrat senators are continuing to fight a short-term government funding measure, raising the real threat of a shutdown, and as of midnight tonight, if the standoff over the coal miners' benefits drags on. Interesting enough, Mitch McConnell, He has done far more against health care than for health care. Remember the Affordable Care Act, Mr. Mitch McConnell. The issue is serious enough for Senator Joe Manchin. Is that his name? Manchin. Manchin. Democrat of West Virginia. Said, I slaughtered his name. Just his name, though. I've never heard of the guy. But he proposed, postponed rather, as planned, meeting with Donald Trump at Trump Tower today. He said, no, I can't make it. Reportedly in a mix of a cabinet position for the upcoming administration, will now meet Trump on Monday, according to a spokesman for the senator. Oh, my goodness. So how about those cran apples? This is the Robert Christian Show. Stay tuned.
Welcome to The Robert Christian Show, going beyond the news, addressing issues that matter. Join me, the David Bowers, as we begin today's show.
And we welcome you wherever around the world that you are. Good evening, everyone. I hope that we have a fantastic week. I hope that you all have so far. As we dive into the news stories, folks, that try to make the world a better place, one news story at a time, one person at a time, that is what we're about. And we are back on the air, folks, and happy. It is to be back. Hey, I do have an honorable mention or an honorable request that was sent in to us. So I'm going to read this, and I did promise I would put the link to this petition on our website news page. RobertChristianShow.com is where you'll find it. I haven't put the link up yet as of this very moment, 3:04 p.m. However, it will be up on, at least for a while, up on our website. Dr. Malachi York was overcharged and oversentenced for nonviolent crimes and is currently serving 135 years at a supermax prison in deplorable conditions, so the email says. He is 71 years old and in failing health. The humane thing to do is for President Barack Obama to grant him a pardon before the president leaves his office and before Dr. York dies. A candlelight vigil is being planned at Lafayette Square, Pennsylvania Avenue Northwest, and 16th Street Northwest in Washington, D.C., scheduled for tomorrow between 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern. So we are going to be, again, I had mentioned to Sherry that I'd get this put out for folks. So I hope that you, that if you're in the D.C. area, you can, of course, show some participation and some respect here. A candlelight vigil for Malachi York at Lafayette Square, Pennsylvania Avenue Northwest, and 16th Street Northwest in Washington, D.C. So, and that is scheduled for tomorrow between 7 or between 9 and 11 p.m. Eastern. So, hey, Sherry, thanks for the notation, and we will hopefully be able to see some sort of a crowd gather in support. In other news, before I actually get into the gist of today's actual show, you know what? I have been in a lot of contact, a lot of communication, a lot of conversation of how that people are very upset, and they're getting very very troubled, becoming very troubled over the impending occupant of Pennsylvania Avenue, and how that the American people did not actually vote for this man, which on the surface you see the person, you see a businessman, which that alone, he's brilliant in business, but to say he is also a fool in politics. Now, I've followed Donald Trump for quite a while, and I have focused plenty of time looking at his business model, of course, good and bad, and of course his political agenda. Because what's happening right now is that we are seeing an absolute divide in America. Ladies and gentlemen, listen to me very carefully and very clearly. And I don't want you to forget it. Because here's the deal. If you want to know what the deal is, well, here it is. The big problem is that what we are seeing is the shirt tail of a rootless dictator. And if the election continues on, if the Electoral College does not change their mind, and if the Electoral College chooses to remain as that the votes were pledged, then it would be the very first American dictator. Now this is. And it really should be alarming. Don't you think? It should absolutely be alarming. Now, why people have chosen to put their head in the sand, they have chosen to look the other way and just think maybe somebody else will do it. Maybe somebody else, you know, let somebody else think about it. Maybe somebody else, you know, wait a second. We can't do that anymore, folks. The game of a tabloid politician, that game is over. You know, a lot of Americans can absolutely and unconditionally see where this is going. But I ask you today, who is it that is going to stand up in opposition? Now, I'm not saying that everything needs a protest. But you know what? This is one of those cases that what I am seeing is an uproar, an uptick in protest. And then the sooner that we get to the inauguration day, the worse that the protests are going to be. Now, am I in support of these protests? I'm in support of change. I am in support of change. I want to see change happen in Washington. Now, has Barack Obama, let's be fair, without being biased, has he been a good president or a great one? I would say he's been a great president. However, not everything that he has done, not everything that he has agreed to, do I support. Absolutely not. One of the things that I do not support is that the way that Obamacare, for an example, the Affordable Care Act, how it still leaves millions of people in a loophole with health care. Now, to me, that's ridiculous. And I look to Barack and I say, naughty, naughty, naughty. Because the Affordable Health Care Act, it should have gone much further. It should have prevented pharmaceutical companies, large and small, from jacking the prices of their of prescription medications to the point where it can't be covered or it won't be covered. That's a start. Another starting point is that the penalty fees, if you don't have Obamacare, if you don't have health care, the extent of those fees, that is a no, Mr. Barack Obama. And to that, I don't agree either. So you see, it's not that I support him because he is Democratic. I support him as being our president. He's been a great president. He has been a man of a lot of firsts. In America, and we've needed that. But whom that we really need as the upcoming president of the United States? He left the race a bit too early. That's my opinion, and I'm going to stick to it, doggone it. But we're going to get into it. Let's go through the news stack, folks. Giuliani, he pulls his name from consideration. For the office of the Secretary of State, apparently he says, no, thanks, but no thanks. President Obama, he orders a deep dive, is what they're calling it, into the election-related hacking by Politico. And you know what? I think that's a good idea. But Mr. Obama, no offense, dear friend, no offense, Mr. President. But really, this is a little bit too late in the game because the election has been so divided. You know that. I know that. Anybody and everybody around the world knows that it has been an absolute division. And we have seen racial tensions in the United States to breaking points. And we are going to continue to see this. We are continuing to see a deep dive, not just in the election, but guess what? You know, a lot of Americans finally get it. A lot of Americans finally get it, that it is not we the people, as our vote, who puts in the next president of the United States. It is the Electoral College. Thus, our single vote for the office of the presidency doesn't do anything except show by number who actually won the popular vote. Now, the popular vote was not won by Trump. It was won by Hillary. You know what? The day before Election Day, folks, historic moment happened. The day before Election Day, I was live, right, on a social platform. And I had asked everybody then, the day before said, you know what, if you have voted early in the early voting, do you want your vote back? If you voted for a candidate, are you sorry now that you did? Some people said, yeah, I want my vote back. Some people said, no. They don't want their vote back because perhaps Hillary, she would dismantle the military like she really was planning on doing so. Trump, on the other hand, he's going to increase the mighty power of military. You know what that's like? That is like every other Republican occupant of the White House. They always have said, well, we've got to have the biggest and the best military, bless God. You know, and they have this thing, this love for weapons. They have this thirst for war. And folks, it's ridiculous. It is absolutely ridiculous. And I say, next. Not quite. In a tape confession in other news, Charleston church shooter says, we all know that I am guilty. As he laughed in court and he said, yes, in fact, I was the one. Yes, I did. He got his 15 minutes of fame and a lifelong legacy of shame. After shooting up the church there in the Mother Emmanuel Church in Charleston, the shooter, he admitted that he was the one who did it. Ridiculous. Oh, mercy. What else is in the news? Donald Trump is the first true reality television president. Actually, they are going to continue to use his name on Celebrity Apprentice. Why they chose to do that, kind of makes you wonder. Senate Dems facing a likely defeat in a showdown fight. You know what? Oh, my goodness. This is going to be something else on today's live show. You guys just watch this. Rupert Murdoch is also making the news. I see seeks to add $14 billion crown jewel, British Sky, to the Fox empire. Trump's labor picks, our labor pick, stiffs his own workers on a retirement plan. Oh, that's great for America. Make America great again. Meanwhile, this guy, it's in the news. I didn't write it. Fortune Magazine did. Facebook plans to keep Zuckerberg in control was flawed, a lawsuit says. Really? Let's see what else is going on. And entertainment. We don't get into entertainment. The War of the Planet of the Apes, Fox debuts extended. Look for Matt Greaves' gritty Western-influenced new sequel. and if you did not know, if you had not heard this, now you will. Fukushima radiation has reached now to the U.S.-American shores. Salem, Oregon, for the first time since the horrific earthquake that happened in Fukushima, Japan. The nuclear disaster has been detected now on the west coast of the United States. However, the health officials are saying that the radiation level is very low and it is not life-threatening anymore on the west coast of the U.S., but it has actually arrived. Okay, so that is sort of kind of where that is. Yeah. Oh, good grief. Hey, folks, there is an awful lot more on the Robert Christian Show. Visit us on the web at robertchristianshow.com. You'll be glad you did. We'll be right back. All right, ladies and gentlemen, This is the Robert Christian Show. If you're just now tuning in, we welcome you. And if you are listening to the show via podcast, do let your family, your friends, your neighbors know about the podcast. Yes, yes. And help us to get the word out. And join us in our quest for equality. Join us in our quest for a balanced news. And hey, we are slightly to the left, just a little bit unbalanced. Let's talk a little bit about John Glenn, the iconic astronaut and politician, as he has died at the age of 95. Ohio Governor John Kasich confirmed in a statement yesterday that John Glenn will always be Ohio's ultimate hometown hero. And has passed today. At this occasion, we all grieve. Kasich wrote in a statement on Twitter, "As we bow our heads and share our grief with his beloved wife, Anne, we must also turn to the skies and salute his remarkable journey and his long years of service to our state and to our nation. Though he soared deep into space and the highlights of Capitol Hill, his heart has never strayed from his steadfast Ohio roots. Godspeed, John Glenn." And Governor Kasich, I could not agree with you anymore. You know, when we have the ability, the knowledge and the power, the might to send a man to the moon, to build what we call the International Space Station, and we are able to sustain life in orbit, flying much faster than the Earth rotates. It's absolutely mind-boggling. John Glenn was a hero to a lot of people. Those that knew him knew that he was someone with vision, somebody with purpose, somebody with experience, because he, among everyone, could say, "Hey, I have been there." No matter if you have ever thought about going to space, everybody at night has looked to the stars at night to see them. At times we get a little aggravated when the sun doesn't shine because it's foggy or because it's a cloudy day. But John Glenn was one of those men that flew above all of that. He reached for the stars. He saw them. And I suggest that forever may he be a star in the history books of America. What a fantastic leader and visionary that John Glenn actually was. That is what I think about it, and we're sticking to it. From Washington, the Robert Christian Show. And we are back, ladies and gentlemen, with the Robert Christian Show, live from Washington. You know, folks, sometime news stories that I get a hold of are just mind-blowing. Here we have Mitch McConnell. Good old Mitch McConnell. Becoming very intolerant of the Democrats. As the Democrats are fighting to block a short-term government funding measure, and yet Mitch McConnell and his counterparts have done the same thing. Well, we're going to close down the government unless Obamacare, unless we can challenge this through the courts and just take up millions of dollars. And unless we can spend all this money, you know, rather than putting the millions of dollars, well, you might as well say $1 billion into government programs, i.e., paying back money that was robbed and taken from Social Security, money that was taken out of Medicare and Medicaid. Rather than doing that, oh no, it was more important to challenge the Affordable Care Act, right? Mitch McConnell said today the Democrats need to take a yes for an answer. No, Mr. McConnell, Mr. Mitch, I don't have to take yes for an answer, but I'm certainly not going to take your no either. He said that he will keep working. Oh, I love this. He said he will keep working next year to resolve the fight over health care benefits for coal miners. Wait a second. Since when did Congress actually work? Duh. Since when did Congress say, you know what, we're going to spend, we were elected to do a job, we're going to work, we're going to do a job. We are going to do what we are supposed to do for the American taxpayer, for the American public that voted us into office. Have they ever said that, this Congress? Having the lowest approval rating ever? Really? And now Mitch McConnell says, and I will work, I will keep working next year to resolve the fight over health care benefits. First, Mitch McConnell, adjust your teeth, would you please? Don't let your false teeth hit the floor and bite you square in the backside. Senate Majority Mitch McConnell is urging the old coal mine state Democrats to take yes for an answer. As a block of Democratic senators continue fighting a short-term government funding measure, raising the real threat of a shutdown as of tonight, if the standoff over coal miners' benefits drags on. Wait a second. Really? So he now is so concerned, or so overly concerned, bless his name, shall we pause and shall we be thankful that finally a Republican, Mitch McConnell, is now saying we have to do something about health care. Remember, he was one of the jokers. He was one of these people that were doing all that they could to keep Obamacare, or the Affordable Care Act, shall I say, from passing, from becoming law. And then once it did, they weren't satisfied with it. They challenge. 60-some-odd times, wasn't it, that the Affordable Care Act was challenged for its legality? And he was trying to take it away. He was trying to say, wait a second, we can't have this. This is America. We can't have this affordable health care stuff. But now he's saying, yeah, we have to now protect the coal miners and their health care benefits. But oh, now there's such a war, there's such a disaster in Congress and in the Senate, because I don't want to. Oh, come on, Mitch McConnell, please. I don't know about you, but, you know, I brought it up in a conversation, folks, and I will leave it here before we go to the bottom of the hour break. But guess what? I had said in a conversation, you know what? If Congress, if the Senate looked at you and said, we will raise your taxes 20 or 30%, for an example, now you say, ouch. But they said, we will give you free health care as a result of it. Unconditional free health care, period. Free education, free higher education, college, etc., period. No ifs, ands, or buts. No questions. That's it. Would you believe them? A lot of people would say, nope. Where do you stand? This is the Robert Christian Show. Stay tuned, and we shall be back with more of this dilemma. And we are back with the Robert Christian Show. And, you know, I rejoice, folks. I get happy about some things in the news. And yet some other things seem to be extremely bad. Or going from bad to even worse. You know, I like a lot of Americans look at what's going on in Congress and in the Senate. And as I've said all along, that what America needs to pay attention to, simply put, is Congress and a very unworkable Senate. We think perhaps that they are willing to work for the American people. And I say, really? We say that our Congress and our Senate are doing a fine job, a fantastic job. They're doing all that they can, and they're doing a great thing. Meanwhile, their approval rating is the lowest that it has ever been. Mitch McConnell, here he is so suddenly worried about a standoff with Democratic senators following a fight over a short-term government funding measure that is going on right now. And he seems to be so worried about it, but yet he wanted to put the wrench in the fire against Obamacare or the Affordable Care Act. You know, again, folks, I have always proclaimed, I have always said that Obamacare, it never was the care-all to end-all. It never was meant to be that. And I've always said that it was that the ground or that it was built on was solid. The idea was right. But what made it a bad decision, a bad thing, was where it did not go far enough. A lot of people are frustrated not being able to afford medication, not being able to go to the doctor. Look at the deductibles. Consider those folks that are just now getting into Obamacare. And so every year that passes, the rate to enter into the programs are going up. And that is a bad idea. That is a very bad thing. And again, I say, shame on you, President Obama. You know better than that. The Affordable Care Act on the surface is a great deal. However, it doesn't go far enough. It gives far less or far more latitude to these pharmaceutical companies and to hospitals than what is necessary. It gives them far more latitude in what they're able to charge, even for the simplest of medication. And then at times you're told, well, this medication, it is not covered under your plan. Really? Then I say, well, then why is it that doctors are prescribing medication that is not covered under that plan? You go to a doctor, you go to a hospital, and hey, it could be for something simple. It could be something very serious. And suddenly, you find out that your health care and what you need, that the doctor who saw you, the anesthesiologist who put you under, right, for surgery, or are those that come into your room to clean it, to prep it, yada, yada. You know, hey, none of that, these people, these vendors were not covered under your plan. Therefore, you're now faced with hundreds, if not thousands, of dollars. And if you no pay, oh no, you no pay, no bill, no. You guys get it? Folks, I've been saying this all along. Now, why is it that only when a big name, a celebrity, brand name celebrity, right, puts their dime's worth, and then suddenly it's breaking news. You won't believe what just happened. Breaking news. This is somebody who said this. Woo! You know what? I've been saying a lot of the same stuff for a long time. For a long time. And you know what? I try to be fair. I try to be balanced. Not unbalanced, but very fair. I like to look at things both sides of the coin. You know, look, I adore President Obama. I do. I think that he's been a fantastic president. But I would not go so far as to say that I agree with everything that he has done. Absolutely not. What about Hillary? I like Hillary a lot. I've got a lot of respect for her. But I can't say that I would support her in every single thing either. Oh, now Trump. You see, folks, it's difficult to separate him from the statements that he has made all along on the campaign trail. Why is that? Because the statements that were made were statements that in public domain everybody heard them. But the problem is that these messages of division, and every time that he would say something, what happened was it propelled him forward. How that happened, I don't get it. Racism in America, is it dead? No. I think that it should be. I think it should be buried. And I really, for that matter, think that America should be very apologetic because of its history. We can look at the history and we can learn from it, but that doesn't mean that history needs to repeat itself again and again. Again, we're seeing white supremacy. And in record number, the alt-right movement, we're seeing this in record number. People are saying, yeah, hurrah, hurrah, hurrah. Finally, our nation is going to be given back to the white man. Look, isn't that a bit racist? I think it is. Do you see what I mean? You see, we can't have a country like this. You can't be a dignified president-elect and make statements against Mexicans, make statements against families, make statements about immigrating and deporting millions of these families that now call America home. You know what? I've got a solution to that. Now, immigration, yes, it's a big thing. It was made a big thing by the Republican Party in this election season. Did you notice that? Like, duh. Did you pay attention? Listen. You know what? Rather than spending the hundreds of millions, if not $1 billion a year, for what has been proposed, this is what I propose. Now, folks, this is one of the beauties of the Robert Christian Show, I must admit. But this is what I propose. Well, who the hell is he to propose? Listen to me, please. What I propose is, rather than spending all of that money to deport and to tear apart families that call America home, make a way, make a concession for these individuals and for these families to become U.S. citizens while they are here. Give them the opportunity to become citizens while they are here. If they did not have enough faith in the American system, I'm not talking about the system of government. I'm talking about the American system. In other words, knowing what America has always been, has been a nation of immigrants. Always. Has it always been that way? The borders of America have always been welcoming. Else, why would we have the Statue of Liberty holding the torch of freedom? Now, if we're not going to have a nation of liberty, might as well give the Statue of Liberty back to France, put it on a ship and say thank you, but no thank you. Now, after so many years, 100 years, 100, 200 years, thanks for the gift, France. Love ya. Hasta la bye-bye. We don't want the statue anymore because it represents freedom. What about that? Yeah, what about that? That's what I'm saying. That's exactly what I'm saying. Now, I get frustrated when you're talking about immigration and you're looking at the policies or the wannabe, wishabe policies on immigration. Look, give these families a chance. Now comes round two. People are saying, hey, give the Donald a chance. give the the Donald Duck, give Donald Trump, give him a chance. I want to know who is going to be the secretary of spray tanning. That's what I want to know. Next. Just saying. But okay, but people are saying give Donald Trump a chance. Absolute, for me, absolutely not. There is no way. Why? It's simple. Because he is not willing to give Americans a chance. He is not willing to give those that live in America, even those who live in the United States illegally, a chance. He is saying, hey, guess what? Vote for me. Hooray, hooray, hooray. Look at all these illicit and stupid things I can say. I can get away with it because, and look at my numbers, they're going through the roof. Really, Donald? Really? You did not win the vote of the people. Guess what Hillary Clinton did? By over or right at 3 million people and counting, you lost the election. So how is it then that somebody who won the popular vote so far hasn't won the Electoral College? Guess what, folks? Oh, my goodness. You guys are going to have to tune in for hour two of today's live show. There's more to it. Now that I have your attention, yes? Now that I have your attention. You know, I like to be, and I want to be unbiased. I look at what's going on, and I try to find an equal balance. Although I am progressive. Although I'm just slightly to the left of center. I prefer being that way. Because I can look at both sides of the fence. I can look at both sides of the argument. And I always welcome a good rounded debate. But not where you're pointing one person to be completely wrong and trying to paint them in the corner. That's not a debate. A good solid debate is, and I learned this years ago, that a good solid debate is that you don't always have to agree with whom that you are debating, but do it agreeably if you disagree. That's a good solid debate. A debate is, it isn't showmanship. Because sometime in a debate, in order to participate in a debate, what we need to do is to do a little homework. We need to focus just a little bit. Really kind of see what's going on around here. That's what I've got to say. Back to Mr. Mitch McConnell. I don't know what it is about this guy, but I'm in a way fascinated with him. This is really bizarre, but in a way, I'm fascinated by this guy. I think for me, it's because he has stood against health care for Americans. He has stood against raising minimum wage. He has stood against Social Security and expanding it. He has stood against Medicare and Medicaid. He has for years. He has stood against the 4% or maybe 5% of the actual American governmental budget every year. He has stood against that part before he would stand against anything else. Why is that? Well, that's where you find Social Security. That's where you find Medicare. That's where you find Medicaid. That is where you find all these other things, these social net programs that help to keep millions of Americans alive. Not living, but existing. So the Republican Party wants to nitpick and take away from that small, very small piece of the pie. Meanwhile, they're spending 57% of our budget annually on military. Now, am I anti-military? No. But what I'm saying is that we are being ripped off. We, the American taxpayer. Not Donald Trump. He don't pay taxes, remember? But the American taxpayer are getting ripped off. Now, what other country around the world would spend 57% of their budget every year on military? Nobody. What other country would do that? Not one. Why? Ah, isn't that interesting? Because they don't have to. They look to America, they look to our ingenuity, they look to our government, they look to our military base and say, help, 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 I'm a fly on the wall. All right, wait. They say, wait a second. Hey, we're the ones over here. We're the ones that need some help, right? We're the ones who need help. Good God Almighty. So send the best, and we have for years. But you know what? It hasn't worked out very well, has it? When we are the ones footing the bill, 57% of the budget going to military alone? No. You know what? If I were president, I'd say, no. No more than about 40%. Can you imagine, people? All right. Could you imagine this? People saying, oh, my God, he's cutting it back. We're going to have the worst military. No, we're going to have a strong military. But we'll be using financing and we'll be doing this to perfection. Look, we have a national debt. And to the trillions of dollars. And so, based on that alone, that's enough to want to wipe out 19 or 20% or more, right, of the military budget and put those billions, hundreds of billions, into the national debt to help to wipe it out. Oh, my goodness. It could be given back to Social Security, given back to Medicare, given back to Medicaid, social programs that help people to live, rather than robbing from these programs just because, it's convenient. Hey, nobody can stop us because we're in Congress. You know what? Congress is going to be very busy. The first 72 hours that Trump is actually in the White House, if it gets that far. We're not to the point yet where the Electoral College has cast their final vote. I hope, as well as a lot of other Americans, that the Electoral College will finally wake up and say, wait a second, we're not going to vote for this guy. We cannot put our vote behind him. We're going to go with another candidate. And I love that. We're going to go for another candidate. Oh, mercy sakes alive. Okay, so, folks, there is an awful lot at stake. And I, you know, it's hard. It really is difficult to separate the man from his statements. I look at the absolute stupidity of it all, and it is. But every time that he has said something, no matter how stupid, how illicit, how sexist or racist that the statements have been made, his approval rating has just gone on and on. You know, look, and I watched it. I covered this. Where major media was covering two events. Bernie Sanders, love you Bernie, and Trump. Trump was late by several hours. But would major media, would they give and put the cameras, put the air on air light on in the Bernie Sanders rallies when he was speaking? Of course not. They focused their cameras on Trump and on his blank platform. The podium that said Trump making America great again. Yeah, so they would rather focus their attention on something that wasn't going on. So were they being fair to Bernie Sanders? No, come on. I don't think so. Folks, this is the Robert Christian Show, where your voice, your opinion do matter. Visit us on the web at robertchristianshow.com. There you will find the streams for the live shows. And hey, right now we are live. I think we're live on, yeah, we're live on Facebook too. Hello, Facebook. And of course, later on today, the podcast will also be up. We're getting there. I'm excited to see the growth in podcasts. To me, it's sort of kind of cool, right? You know, because I think that we are where people are and where people need to be. So we're presenting content that I guarantee you will not find anywhere else. I have been looking at the news. I've been looking at news items. I've been looking and seeking for an element of truth. And, you know, in every news story, there is an element of truth. There is something that we can learn, of course, from each other if we would listen. So, again, you know, there's nothing wrong with a good debate. But a good debate is not trying to show one person up and down and trying to paint each other into a corner. But a good debate is focusing on issues. A good debate is offering a ray of hope to everybody. It is presenting a fact or an idea and see what other people say about it. See what other people say and how that perhaps that their opinions could actually change yours. Wow. So having said that, folks, we have a great show upcoming in the upcoming hour, the Robert Christian Show. My prediction for the first 72 hours after Inauguration Day. What is going to happen over that weekend? You see, Inauguration Day is a Friday. I looked it up. January the 20th. So what is going to happen on the 21st, the 22nd, and the 23rd, which is a Monday? Ain't it great? Folks, there's more to it. I'm Robert Christian. We'll catch you all, folks, after the top of the hour.